Professor Moore as our opening academic speaker this year, so this is the first academic lecture of MSIS this year. We thought we'd start with someone new and snazzy to the department. So she does her seminar in Women and Quasi-Religious Life as well, which is the SMC 406, as well as the two medieval Latin classes, so the introductory Latin and the intermediate Latin. So today she's going to talk about women in the Middle Ages and in religious life. So I will hand it over to you.
Well, thank you so much to Rachel for that lovely introduction and to all of you for being here. It's a small enough group that I'm really looking forward to being able to share some of this stuff and with you, and especially having a chat afterwards and finding out a little bit more about you and figuring out a little bit more about about your interests in medieval culture. I know here that the Medieval Studies Society is being introduced to. It's a really exciting and a really dynamic program, and I'd love to figure out how I can be part of it. And for those of you who are interested in the subject, whether you're in my classes or not, please, I'm happy to get in touch. I'm really excited to discuss all of this material with you. So the subject I'm going to talk to you about today, the material comes from a larger project, which is actually forthcoming from Oxford University Press and should be out in December. So I'm really hoping to be able to do some sort of workshop around the publication of that, maybe some further discussions about the whole mysterious world of academic publishing, or maybe some just sessions on the material itself. But today you all get a sneak preview, so you can be very, very excited by that. So the women that I'm going to be talking about today are known by various names. A caveat before I begin is that if any of you are familiar with any of these groups, you may know them by other names. The material deals with women who were discussed under various names, and their names change regularly. So when I talk today about beguines or penitents, I'm thinking of beguine in the sense of, in the original sense of the word, which was a woman who was commonly discussed as a beguine. Mulher is quite a chuntur beguina, women who were called, literally in the vulgar tongue, but just commonly, beguines. And, of course, the reasons for this will become apparent, but we can discuss how familiar you are with any of these groups and what sort of contexts you've encountered them in a little bit afterwards. So, in the later 13th century, a Franciscan preacher, Guibert of Tournai, complained, saying, "There are among us women that we do not know what to call, lay women or nuns, for they neither live in the world nor out of it." Now, Guibert's complaint, that trivial as it might seem, looking back from the 21st century viewpoint, pointed to an ongoing discussion among feminists. How do we discuss, and how do we discuss people who don't quite fit into the standard categories? And for Guibert, the bigger problem was, and how do we fit them into this rather peculiar, changing ecclesiastical landscape? Now, this wasn't just a problem at the end of the 13th century. There have always been women who existed on the margins of religious life. There have been women in religious communities, but there have also been pious lay women, some of whom chose to retreat into their own homes, some of whom chose to dedicate themselves to a life of charity, some of whom chose to dedicate themselves to a life of prayer. From the early 13th century onwards, these women became so numerous that, they started to be the subject of much discussion. In the early 13th century, the popular preacher, Jacques de Vitry, later Cardinal Bacher, a very important man, ended up pointing to the number of women, and also also pointing to the fact that they had no definite status, was he? He said, such women are called Beguines in Flanders and Brabant, Papillarte in France, Humiliate in Lombardy, and Bizzocche in Italy. He noted that all of these women were behaving in a manner that church and society didn't really accept. Their daring feat wasn't challenging orthodoxy or espousing any type of heretical doctrine. It was simply endeavouring to make the world a better place. Leaving aside the traditional choices of marriage or the convent, these women lived either alone or in small communities. Some worked with lepers, others worked with the poor, some were teachers to other women, some taught larger public groups, and others found ways of preaching the gospel life. The one thing they shared was their form of devotion existed on the margins. They had a spirituality that was entirely shaped by their changing world and conformed precisely to the social needs of their day. Nevertheless, their stories are virtually unknown. They're either recorded in incomplete and fragmentary records or filtered through a canonical, often a clerical gaze, through which they became known as members of religious orders. In many cases they were, but in many cases these women were entirely lay. It's also important to point out that this phenomenon was not unique to any one place or time. You had similar communities in what's now Belgium. They're known as Beguines. You have here the altarpieces a little bit later from Mechelen, and if you look at it very, very closely, you can see women who were engaged in all manner of tasks, from caring for the poor to just carrying out laundry. Other parts of modern-day Benelux, this image is from the Beguinage in Amsterdam, which still functions as a community for women who wanted to engage in a socially active life. This image is Elizabeth of Hungary. In the German lands, she served to the poor and predominantly lepers. Other communities later ended up selecting her as a patron. In Italy, you see women following a very, very similar form of life. This woman we'll look at a little bit more closely later on. Her name is Margaret of Cortona, and contrary to what her habit or habitual like and dress might suggest, she was a pious lay woman, and extended all over the place. This particular community was in Scotland a little bit later, the Hospital Sisters of Aberdour. Most of the communities, hospital communities in Scotland, left very few and fragmentary records. You also got a lot of communities in what's now Eastern Europe. Hungary had a very, very vibrant Beguine tradition, as did other parts of what's now considered Eastern Europe. And this whole business of looking at these women through a lens of religious life has become so prevalent that almost everyone who is familiar with Elizabeth of Hungary will think of her as a Franciscan. Almost everyone who is familiar with Zita of Lucca will think of her as a Dominican. And Bega, of course, saintly queen from about the 9th century, became a Beguine, even though she would have been completely unfamiliar with the movement in the 16th century. But the story that I'm going to tell is not one of identity appropriation, but one that has blurred boundaries between lay and religious and has been instrumental in creating what's now commonly thought of as tradition. As I mentioned earlier, this way of life had been going on for centuries. Before getting into exactly what these women were doing, I want to draw attention to a few points. First of all, the fact that this phenomenon was trans-regional, brought together various different areas of Europe that are now commonly studied only in isolation from each other, is something that's gone virtually unnoticed. Jacques noticed this when he gave his homily, but whenever, in the rare cases where these women are discussed, they're completely spoken about in isolation. The second thing to note is that Jacques' terminology, he points out that these women are known by a number of names. Look at houses where the women in it are sometimes called penitents, sometimes called beguines. We'll end up with phrases like the beguines of the Third Order of St. Francis, and all kinds of things that are completely inconsistent. As well as the terms that Jacques was using, we get all kinds of mantellate, the ones with the mantle, velate, the veiled ones. This okay, I mentioned that takes its it really refers to the kind of shoes that the women were wearing. The word beguine itself, well, a lot of ink has been spilled trying to figure out exactly what one means by beguine. There have been theories linking it with St. Bega, but of course that's a much later fabrication. There have been theories linking it with a man called Lambert Le Beg, who was bishop in and around Liège, and who did a lot of work with quasi-religious women. But again, it doesn't seem as though his name was taken and used consistently. There are other things associated with the word to pray or associated with the word to beg, but really it's scholarly conclusions are, it's no more than educated guesswork. Now, to introduce these women in their way of life, I think I'll take a page out of Jacques's book and tell a story. Some of you will be familiar with this woman, Marie of Ligny, and there is one copy of her manuscript that's now in Baltimore, so I guess it's close enough that you can go and look at it from her life. Now, in the prologue to this life of Marie de Ligny, Jacques describes a young woman who longed to dedicate herself to religious life as a Cistercian nun. She followed in the footsteps of Cistercians who came and visited, and she had planned this from a very, very young age. As typically happens in these hagiographic vitae, her parents had other ideas and decided to arrange for her to marry a young man of a, quote-unquote, not dissimilar social station. This young man was named Jean. On their wedding night, Marie told her new husband that she had already made a vow of chastity and their marriage would be unconsummated. We are never told of his reaction to this vow, but we do know that the two went and dedicated themselves to serving lepers. Now, Jacques was undoubtedly aware of Jean, and we can talk about Jacques and men and how quasi-religious men needed different forms of support later on, but he focused his attention on Marie. Specifically, he drew attention to the fact that she was not the only one living such a life. He said in his prologue, "You saw many holy virgins in the little garden of the Lord," which is a very difficult phrase to say, and by which he means Liège. And he says, "And you rejoiced. You saw crowds of them in different places where they scorned carnal enticements for Christ, despised the riches of the world for love of the heavenly kingdom, clung to their heavenly bridegroom in poverty and humility, and earned a sparse meal with their hands." The women that Jacques is describing, he mentions a few of them. One of them seems to be Lucard, who was an abbess nearby, worked with lepers. Another seems to be a woman who really preached a message of purgatory from the same region. The life of Marie was extremely successful. There's never been a real critical edition of the manuscripts for all of you Latinists who want a project, but there are at least 26 of them that are known. Most of them are in Latin, but they also circulated in Dutch, in English, and surprisingly enough, in Norwegian. So this was something that really had a popular message. And really, again, that points to that trans-regional phenomenon. There were women living this kind of life. And really what this life kind of life was you see here, a beguinage, a little one in Mechelen. And Mechelen is an interesting city. So if you go there, you're told that there are something like 36 speaking continents, and you think that must be absolutely astounding. Most of them are tiny. They're small houses that really two or three women would have lived in. This is, well, obviously heavily restored, but there are little streets that surround the church. These women had the church and had the sacraments really at the center of their life, but what they saw and what they wanted to do with their life was really a kind of socially active devotion. Now, of course, uncloistered women, women being active in the world, caused all kinds of consternation and controversy, as you may see suggested by the rather provocative marginalia to this particular manuscript that has a Beguin and a Bigard. There were detractors of these women who were afraid that their contact with secular men would lead them into disrepute or lead them into sin. Even, of course, women who were working with lepers. So, of course, you can imagine that romance was probably not on your mind when you were washing someone who's had scabs all over his body, and sometimes his body parts would fall off. But this was a concern that was raised. Another concern that was raised is many of them would preach or teach or speak publicly. And there were a number of people who saw them, saw that they were living in communities. Some of them were dressing alike and thinking that these were a kind of nun. Well, of course, that causes all sorts of difficulty. One of the things that Jacques and his contemporaries were trying to do is say, no, look, these women are doing these things. Yes, they may look as though they were virtual, but they're things that are really needed to in this world. Jacques called Marie a new saint for a new age. And you see a number of similar vitae. Eventually, this whole business of having your hagiographer defend you was not enough, and you start seeing Beguines getting something a little closer to a typical religious rule. And the graphic that you see here comes from a project that I'm involved in creating an edition of Beguine rules. Now, I'm working on this with a colleague from Belgium, and it's taken a little bit longer than we thought, because I think our original division of labor is I would take all the Latin, she would take all the Flemish, and we'd share the French. But of course, we get into these texts and find that they begin in one language, switch to another, seemingly for no reason, and change to a third. They're all seeming to do the same thing, really, quasi-religious life, but they're really sort of... He uses different terminology. So one of the things that we had to do in the very, very beginning is figure out which words were not exactly translations, but equivalences. And of course, the rule and regula are fairly consistent. Statute was a custom. It varies from house to house. And sort of piecing it all together was a little bit of a nightmare. By about 1246, there was a sort of standard Beguine rule, although it doesn't seem as though many Beguine houses followed it. Many of them had it, but the things that were written on and sort of obviously used were things that were more along these lines of common house rules, much more informal statutes. So we'll leave that model of recognition for a second, and we'll jump to Italy. Just look at another form, something a little bit more, something that has been a little bit more long-lasting. You saw the woman that I mentioned here, and we had her, this image, earlier. We have her tale is Margaret of Cortona. Her life was written by Franciscan and Giunta Bettignati very, very shortly after her death. And her story it's very typical of some forms of sanctity, but it's one of those, if one were living her life, one would not necessarily have thought at any given point she would be a saint. She was born to a family of lower social status. She fell in love with a lord whose name is commonly had given as Arsenio, but that comes from much, much later tradition. The only reference to him in the manuscript is A. The two went, fell in love. They couldn't marry because of his social station, but they lived together, and as these things often happen, they had a child. Margaret's world changed completely when Arsenio died very, very suddenly. Because she was not his legal wife, she had no rights to their home. His family, because of the scandals she had brought, really didn't want anything to do with her. And her own family, again, because of her scandalous habit of running off and living with lords and having their children, weren't too keen on having her back. So from a place of complete and utter despair, Margaret decided to dedicate herself to the Lord. She approached the local Franciscans, who, of course, were a little bit cautious of coming too close to a woman who was known, really, or had a reputation as a seductress, and found herself, instead, going to a small home where she was taken in by two noble women and ran a house for women who were pregnant in the hospital for new mothers. She soon gained a reputation for sanctity, and what you see here is something called a panel vitae. You may have seen similar ones for Claire, for Francis, I think there's also one for Dominic, which is the image of the saint that is surrounded by incidents from her life. And for Claire, it's of course Claire being tonsured in all of this. For Margaret, you can't see them quite as well, the image is kind of damaged. We'll do things like her giving away her clothes. There's a 17th century image that's a little bit clearer. Giving away her clothes isn't too terribly controversial, although when I guess you have a bit of a reputation, it's probably not a sort of automatic hallmark of sanctity. Another one is, of course, this more controversial act where there was a man who was committing suicide, and Margaret cut him down. You can see off in the corner the little demon flying away from where she cut him down. And she, as the legend says, she sat down with him and she comforted him. Well, Margaret was an example of living piety. She did all of these things, some of which were controversial, some of which were recognized as needed, but most of which were just for nuns did not do that. These women really went where no nuns had gone. But again, like the Beguines, who were doing very, very similar things in very, very similar ways, this was controversial and needed to be more closely regulated. The manuscript that you see here is from an edition of a text known as Supramontum. Supramontum was created at the end of the 13th century by a Franciscan pope, Nicholas IV. And Nicholas claimed to give authority to an order that Francis of Assisi had founded. There are several vita of Francis of Assisi that will say he founded three orders, friars, clerics, and the so-called third order. If we look a little bit closely, we see that he only arguably founded one. The whole story of the clerics is, I think, as Berus and Claire and Kathy Mooney have explored in recent work, was later, and it was papal creation. And the same is true for the third order. While Francis certainly did interact with lay people, there's no evidence that he founded such an order. And this is something that was being promoted round about the time that Margaret lived. Margaret embodied the sort of need for such an order, and the Franciscan Pope decided that such an order would be created round about this time. Of course, there seems to have been a little bit more to the Franciscan Nicholas's institution of this bull than the simple desire to honor the founder of his order. In 1274, the Second Council of Lyon had decided that they would re-emphasize an earlier prohibition, a prohibition that had brought in by the Fourth Lateran Council that no new religious orders be created. For any of you who work with religious women, you'll know, or work with religious life in general, you'll know that, of course, the effects of this 1250, or this Fourth Lateran Council decree, where there are no new religious orders except where there were. One of these new religious orders was, of course, this Third Order, by saying that it was founded by Francis, who had died in 1226, and who had had permission to found his own order in 1209, Nicholas was making sure that this Third Order would first of all be recognized, and secondly, that no one would question the legitimacy of its existence. It was a religious order that really got around all these niceties of canon law. Would have been the end of the story, except, well, then you start seeing this sort of whole convoluted list of regulation and regularization, most of which was focused on quasi-religious women. In 1298, very shortly after this 1289 Supramontem, Pope issued a decretum called Periculosa, which stated that religious women, moniales, those who were entitled to use the term moniales and be given the benefits and obligations thereof, had to be enclosed. A number of canonists went on to argue that the 1289 Supramontem exempted these women who belonged to a third order from this requirement of enclosure. And not surprisingly, this rule of the third order spreads quite rapidly. We have another development in 1311 when the Council of Vienne condemned the beings as pernicious and detestable women. Of course, it also reaffirmed the right of pious women who were called by the Lord to live in their own houses in the manner to which forever they were called. The Council gave absolutely no guidance on whether one or how one was to distinguish these pernicious and detestable women from their pious and God-fearing sisters. And later, canonists were really left to fend for themselves. So the situation in the early 14th century is that we still have a number of houses of religious women. We still don't have a proper rubric under which they can be discussed, but we have several attempts to regulate them. We have women who are acknowledged as beings in one area. We've got women who are acknowledged as belonging to the Third Order in another area. And we've got a Third Order rule, which women seem to adopt just so they can be exempt from this requirements of periculosa and later from the condemnation of the Council of Vienne. What ends up happening is the word tertiary and the word beguine really do end up both just overlapping, being used interchangeably. The next development would be an attempt to clear up this whole situation, but which really made it worse was the Constituzione Clementine in 1317, which really was the last collection of canon law to circulate. As a result, it meant that this condemnation of beguines by the Council of Vienne, which probably would have been a relatively minor point in canon law, ended up being circulated, ended up being discussed over and over and over again. Again, communities throughout Europe, we still have women called beguines, but more and more communities were encouraged to take on religious rules or to take on the appearance of religious life. You start to see another attempt at order and monasticization with something called observant reform. Now, the observant reform movement, it spanned all of Europe. It had no geographical boundaries, much like these quasi-religious women. It wasn't particular to any one order. You have Carmelites who were observance, Franciscans, Dominicans. And what they shared was a desire to return to a pristine age before corruption had ever entered Christianity. Now, the fact that this age had probably never existed didn't really deter these reformers to any great degree, and instead they endeavored to create this. One of the disorderly elements that they were attempting to bring order to was quasi-religious women. They shared ideals about these women through model sermons. It came up, Giovanni Capistrano came up with very, very strict guidelines for tertiary communities. He acknowledged, of course, that tertiary communities should exist and that there had always been women in the church who had existed outside of religious orders and lived perfectly orthodox lives. However, he said because of the dangers of the modern age, it was now necessary for them to live in community and for them to live enclosed lives. Tertiaries who were influenced by Giovanni ended up largely being from Southern Europe and really were, more often than not, influenced. Tertiaries in Northern Europe, well, the picture is a little bit murkier. You get things like there's a beautiful beguinage in Nijmegen, where it was a beguinage until the early 15th century, where it's when the observant Franciscans came to Nijmegen, and then the Franciscan Annales Minorum talks about it being founded in that year. Never mind the 100 years of earlier existence, but it had been founded in that year as a Franciscan convent. The stories of these houses are recorded in histories. Capistrano's story extraordinarily influential. Another history of Mariano of Florence. Now, these men were both Italian, but their histories of tertiaries encompassed all of Europe. And in that newly created tertiary order, they would include anyone from sort of 13th century Germany to 14th century in the south of France, people who there was no unifying social station, no unifying form of life. But what seemed to motivate Capistrano and Mariano of Florence to bring these together was really to create an order and to create this illusion of religious life. Now, the interesting bit. What were the women doing? Exactly the same thing. The book that I have that will be coming out is basically a history of how men told women that they should behave and how women behaved in response. You still have communities of women that are serving the sick, you still have women that are working with lepers, you still have women who are working alongside men in almshouses, in creating these spirit tables in the modern-day Low Countries, and still giving food to the poor. We still have women who are teaching and who are spreading messages, and women who are speaking up for themselves and saying, look, we can be perfectly faithful and still live in this way. One of my favorite examples comes from a young woman named Alit Baka, who very, very faithfully copied out 72 servants that were attributed to the Augustinian Giordanos of Quedlinburg in her convent. And at the end of the added two texts of her own, she, of course, these texts are generally not called sermons because it's a woman who's writing them and a woman who is reading or, dare we say, preaching them. And in the first one, she basically begins by saying, if Blessed Brother Giordanus had actually thought about it, this is what he would have said. I'm using a very free translation. But the issue that Alit is having with him is on this idea of religious life in the world or religious life in a cloister. Giordanus maintains that those in the cloister are closest to Christ, fixed because they separate themselves from the world. Alice is saying that yes, those who are called to that form of life are very close to Christ and really have their way, their place in the world. However, she says, those of us who are living the Vita Apostolica, or the living in the world, the life of service, are really doing the same thing Christ was doing, doing the same thing his apostles are doing, and aren't we also close to Christ? Thank you.